Now, the man we have gathered here to pay our centenary tribute to was a person of small physical stature. Clothed in a dhoti, barefooted or wearing sandals, with his cheap pocket watch suspended on a piece of string and a pair of steel-rimmed glasses to complete the picture. In fact, to some, he must have seemed a funny little figure. But within the small framework of his body, there was a heart so large as to encompass all the poor and the suffering, a heart ready to forgive and to find excuses for those people who were his enemies. It didn't matter to him that unthinking people made derisive remarks about his appearance. At the time, baggy knickerbockers were popular over here. He forestalled comment on his loincloth with the remark, "Others wear plus fours, I wear minus fours." He only cared that people should follow his preaching and his personal example of nonviolence. His message, like his clothes, was simple. It was to obey the teaching of Jesus, "Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." As I've said in the foreword to the brochure, it is impossible to measure the goodwill toward India generated by the Gandhi centenary celebrations. I'm particularly glad of this, as I attach tremendous importance to the continuing goodwill between British and Indian people. And yet, there have been isolated instances which can harm those good relations, particularly if they are reported or reprinted in India without being refuted. One writer suggested that India would be better off today and healthier in mind without the Gandhian heritage. He was referring specifically to the fact that Gandhi's spinning wheels cannot compete with factories, and that the most vital fluid is the water from large modern irrigation dams for the country's parched fields. But these are facts that Gandhi would never have disputed. No one was keener on widespread irrigation, and the spinning wheel was merely a token to give unemployed villagers useful work and to make all feel that they could contribute something at once to the welfare of their country. A voluble young Indian communist in a TV discussion following an admirable TV program on Gandhi claimed that Gandhi's nonviolence had been disastrous, as it had prevented the bloodshed without which India could never rid herself of the capitalist classes. He also accused Gandhi of being a party to the disastrous division of India. No one who believes in peace and nonviolence would accept his first criticism. But the second is more insidious, as he spoke as though he had some inside knowledge of Gandhi's mind. The plain fact is that Mahatma Gandhi's two main aims in his struggle were firstly to win independence for India and to keep a link with the British Commonwealth in doing so, and secondly, he wished to maintain the unity of India, which he admitted to me was Britain's finest legacy to India. By 1947, it was only too clear that he could not have both his aims. India could remain unified in the way he wanted only if British rule were maintained. The independence he so ardently desired would only be accepted by the powerful Muslim League if the Muslim majority population could break away and form Pakistan. In his despair, he tried ingenious devices, even suggesting I should summon Mr. Jinnah, their powerful leader, and invite him to form the interim government at the center, with members of the Muslim League and any others he might choose. Power would be turned over to them, and they would make of it what they could. I said he must first get the agreement of the Congress party leaders, which of course he failed to do. All this is told in Henry Hodgson's marvelous history of the transfer of power called The Great Divide. He was terribly upset when I came back from the meetings in London at which the government agreed to my 3rd of June plan, by which the Indian provinces would themselves have to decide whether, on attaining independence, the country was to remain unified under some form of central government or be divided. He realized that this would result in partition. I quickly obtained the agreement of the principal parties to the plan, but my contacts warned me that Gandhi was in a mood to denounce it at his next prayer meeting. So I asked Gandhiji, as I used to call him, to come and see me and expected a very painful interview. But when he entered my study in Viceroy's house, he had his fingers to his lips to signify it was a day of silence. I heaved a sigh of relief. I used all my tact in my one-sided talk to convince him that the new plan was the only possible way to achieve an early and peaceful transfer of power. I urged him not to speak against the plan at his prayer meeting. He replied by scribbling with a stub of a blunt pencil on the back of some used envelopes, which I have kept in my archives. Now, I looked them up last week, and this is what he wrote. "I'm sorry I cannot speak. When I took the decision about the Monday silence, I did reserve two exceptions, i.e. about speaking to high functionaries on urgent matters or attending upon sick people. But I know you do not want me to break my silence. Have I said one word against you during my speeches? If you admit that I have not, your warning is superfluous." He did not denounce the plan, for there was, in fact, no other way at that late date by which power could be transferred to India. But to suggest that he agreed with the division of India is manifestly unfair to his memory. There have been a very few people, I suspect, mainly those who resented India getting her independence, who have been unable to resist pointing the figure of Schadenfreude at the troubles in India. One writer claims that Mahatma Gandhi's spirit was extinguished in India today, 100 years after he was born. He points out that violence and riots between Hindus and Muslims even took place in Gandhi's birth state, Gujarat, as a climax to a year of increasing violence. At the same time, he states that India has spent millions of rupees this year to convince herself and the world that the Mahatma spirit still lives. How dare a British correspondent criticize money spent to publicize the Mahatma spirit and attempts to show the essential need for the policy of nonviolence to be kept truly alive? After all, the riots in India are between two communities of entirely different creeds, worshipping utterly different gods. Here in the United Kingdom, we're still witnessing riots and violence between people who are Christians and worship the same God, though in different churches. We claim to be educated. The Indians are still largely illiterate. But the two governments are striving to bring back peace and harmony among their peoples. The only valid criticism is not that too much money is spent on propagating Gandhi's policy of peace and nonviolence, but that the steps to implement this policy are insufficiently effective. And there are sections of the community that appear to be fanning the flames instead of trying to extinguish them. The main aim of the Gandhi centenary celebrations must surely be to get people all over the world to see that nonviolence is the only civilized way of dealing with any problem, whether it be the threat of war between nations or a local religious dispute. The Prince of Wales is not yet 21. He speaks for youth, and it is youth which must embrace the philosophy of nonviolence. The older generations have twice made a mess of things, and two world wars resulted. A third world war, inevitably escalating to all-out nuclear attacks, would destroy the entire civilization. Let us hope His Royal Highness's generation will do better and decide, as students all over the world, to avoid violence in their own affairs. Thus, when they attain positions of high responsibility, they may be imbued with the vital need for peaceful solutions in all, and I mean all, disputes. I cannot do better than end by quoting the President of India, Mr. Geary's own message to his nation on the centenary of Gandhi's birth. "He stood for love in the midst of hate, forgiveness in the midst of vengeance, good in the midst of evil, and steadfastness in the midst of peril."